إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وقال الله سبحانه وتعالى أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون وبعد my beloved brothers and sisters, we begin as we always like to do by expressing words of gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who have blessed us with so much that often we become so busy and consumed with enjoying the bounties of the dunya and all that Allah has blessed us with that we forget to say thanks. And so we always like to begin by acknowledging to Allah all that He gives us each and every day, whether we commit sins or not, whether we obey Him or not. Allah's mercy continues to extend over all of us. Now, when we go to the hospital, one of the most exciting things besides seeing people who are sick is the birth of a new baby. And when you see a baby gets born, the things which makes you think is the baby gets born, but the baby didn't have any decision in relation to who would be its parents. It wasn't consulted of who their parents. When a baby gets born, it is not asked what race you want to be. When a baby gets born, it is not asked you want to be rich or poor. Baby gets born into a billionaire's home or a pauper. Baby doesn't get to have any conversation about which country they want to be born in, what color skin they would like to have. All of this is decided by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that baby. Whether it's going to have a disability or not, which country, which shape, which all of this stuff, Allah decides for that baby. And babies come in all sizes, shapes, weights, heights, religion of the different parents, and so on. And as that baby grows up and becomes a person, an adult person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us what that baby and all of us who are babies wants, what we are asked from Allah to do. There is a surah or a chapter in the Quran. Imam Shafi said, if this was the only chapter that was to be revealed and nothing else of the Quran, it would be enough guidance for us. And that surah is a very small surah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wal as, innal insana lafi khusr illa. A very profound, terrifying, but very important phrase. Allah begins the surah, by time through the ages, humanity will lose, except. So Allah is telling us that all of us, in the competition against time, we cannot win, except. And then He's going to tell us who are the exceptions that will actually win. Who are the ones who will be successful against time? And then He mentions, إِلَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ وَتَوَاسَوْا بِالْحَقِّ وَتَوَاسَوْا بِالصَّبْرِ. Except those who believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do righteous deeds and exhort each other with truth and patience. What a profound thing to say. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not mention, except those who are born in America, except those who have a PhD, except those who have X amount of wealth, except those, none of that. He put in the category of people who will succeed. Country, race, all the things I told you about the baby, Allah didn't list none of that as the criteria of how you will win. What He said instead, except those who believe in Allah, except those who do righteous deeds, those who exhort each other with truth and patience. And those four things are within the purview, within the capacity of every human being to acquire. So despite the seemingly disadvantaged birth you may have, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it so that you could find Him. Allah guides, true. But Allah said, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَّهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا. That if you strive and make effort towards Allah, Allah will guide you. There's a promise and a commitment from Him. And so the essence of life in the dunya is to be able to arrive at the place where we believe in Allah, we do righteous deeds, and we do these things. The Prophet told one man, آمنت بالله ثم استقم. Believe in Allah and be upright. Act upon that. And how do we define righteous deeds and belief? Is as explained and laid out by Rasulullah ﷺ, who came with this system. For Allah says, إِنَّ الدِّينَ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ الْإِسْلَامِ. That the only system of righteousness and of good deeds that will be accepted by Allah is the one taught by Islam. So it's a very specific. You're not allowed to make up your own righteous deeds or your own belief system or your own version of truth and patience. It is defined by Allah in Deen Islam. And so we are placed in the dunya and asked to find that goal, that purpose that will bring success against time. And in the dunya, no matter how complex your life may seem, there are only three things that we are navigating in the dunya. Our whole life, it's just three things. First thing we navigate in the dunya is stuff. I like the word stuff because it includes all the material things that we do, including money and everything. We spend our life navigating stuff. We acquire it, we store it, we sell it, we barter in it, we fix it, we repair it. We do all kinds of things with stuff. And out of all this stuff, money is perhaps the important one because it allows you to buy more stuff and to buy all the stuff that you need. And all the money you get in the world, there's also only four things we can do with it. Number one is to use some of it to survive our daily needs, to make ourselves comfortable. You know, you use some of that. All the stuff that you have, to make yourself comfortable so that you survive in a fairly comfortable way. Number two is to improve the environment, improve quality of life. You use stuff and money for that. Number three is to help other people who don't have enough stuff, that you may facilitate them to get some of it. And number four is to spend stuff and money to promote Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's da'wah and Allah's way. These are the four things that we spend stuff. We spend whatever we have, our money on. Survive, improve the planet and the technology, help some people, and spend some fi sabilillah for the purpose of advancing Allah's way. So all the things we have, these are the four things that we do with them. And Islam is not anti-stuff. And I'll come to that just now. The second thing we navigate in the dunya is relationships. You have to interact with animals, you have to interact with people, we have to interact with people that behave like animals. We have many kinds of relationship that we have to interact with. And so that is another dimension of our life in the world. Navigating stuff, navigating relationships. And the third is how we deal with the planet. Because we live here on the planet. And so we have to navigate how we are going to be treating the planet, how we occupy the planet, how we deal with it. And so, in relation to stuff, we look at our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, and we see examples of how they navigated stuff. And what we noticed was that among them, there were those who had a lot of stuff. Like Abu Bakr radiallahu anh, like Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu anh, who would be considered like billionaires in today's society. Like Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anh. So we see those who had a lot of stuff. So obviously having a lot of stuff is not a bad thing, because Abu Bakr is among the most lauded of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He had a lot of it. And then we see those Sahaba radiallahu anh, who had nothing. literally would stand on the corner and hope someone invite them in so that they can get a meal for the day, who had literally nothing. But what we noticed was that the sayings of the Prophet ﷺ and the encouragement of Allah, like the Prophet ﷺ said, yes, it's okay to have a lot of stuff, but there's a certain condition, that stuff don't distract you from the greater purpose of committing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, committing to righteous deeds, committing to belief in Allah. If your stuff begins to move you away from that objective, then that stuff is not good for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Al-haakumu takathur. Abundance distracts you. That's when Aisha radiallahu anha, she wanted to make his bed a little bit softer. And he said, no. I may not be able to wake up in the night to pray. If this little soft bed is going to distract me from doing what I'm supposed to do, of that goal of serving Allah, then that stuff is not good for me. When they came to Umar al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu, who had a coat with patches, and they said, let's buy you a new coat, because people are visiting you as the dignitary and the leader. He said, no, I'm too afraid to buy a new coat. It may go to my head. In other words, I'm following the Prophet ﷺ and Abu Bakr, and I want to remain as simple as I can. I don't want the stuff to get in the way of the goal of serving Allah and doing those righteous deeds. Kun fi dunya ka annaka ghareeb aabir as-sabeel. The Prophet said, be in the world as if you are a stranger or you're just traveling through. Don't become so consumed that it begins to take you away from what is the reality. A man came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, جاء رجل إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقال دلني على عمل إذا عملته أحبني الله وأحبني الناس. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied, اذهب في الدنيا يحبك الله وزد فيما عند الناس يحبك الناس. Man came and says, can you tell me something that I can do that will cause Allah to be pleased with me and people to be happy with me as well? And he said, become detached from the dunya. Don't get involved in allowing it to be. And Allah will love you. And become detached from what people have, and they will get to love you. The issue with stuff, it's okay to have stuff if you own the stuff and you control it. What is bad is when the stuff controls you and owns you, that you spend an extraordinary amount of time just gathering and packing and doing all of that stuff, that you don't have time for yourself. And so we are taught that we must be very careful in how we manage the stuff of the dunya, and don't let it consume you to such an extent that you're constantly busy. The second thing is in terms of relationships, that we are asked everywhere you look at our religion, we say, innama al-mu'minuna ikhwa, the believers are brothers. Khaliqin nas bi khuluqin hasan, treat people with good, nice morals and etiquette. We're asked to respect people, to treat them with dignity, to honor them, to respect them as human. In our navigating of relationships, we're asked to be very careful how we deal with others. In terms of animals, even when we go to kill an animal to eat, we ask Allah's permission. I'm about to take a life for food. When we go hunting, we're not allowed to have scatter shots and kill 50 ducks when we are only eating two. We're not allowed to burn down trees and destroy the landscape. Relationships with people, very important. Even among ourselves. And in relation to the planet, you know, Allah tells us, إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا مَا عَلَى الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا لِنَّبْلُوَهُمْ أَيُّهُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا, that we have made this earth and put so many beautiful things. Nature is beautiful. We spend money on vacations to go see them. The beautiful mountains and lakes and deserts and rivers. Allah says, I have beautified the earth for you so that it will be easy for us to live in it. He could have made it so terrible that it would be like a suffering to be in the earth. But He has made it so beautiful in our eyes in order to try us and to see those of us who will do right by it and treat it well. And so these are the three things that we navigate in the world, and our deen teaches us in detailed rules of how we need to behave and how we need to deal with these three things. The person who have a lot of money but is spending it in the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is spending it to help others, is spending it to improve the world and also be comfortable, that person is truly blessed because they are spending their wealth in the proper way. Now, we live in a society, fast forward 21st century today, and so we live in a society where we are now in this time in history, and we have to navigate the same three things: stuff, people, relationships, and the earth. But we live in a society where there's a certain cultural norm that we have to understand and be careful about. In this society, one of the cultural norms is that people love to acquire more stuff that they can use or need. We have this insatiable appetite to acquire as much stuff as possible. Every single person sitting in this carpet here today have a storage problem. If you ask any sister sitting at the back, could you do with a little bit more storage? Sure. All of us would love to have a little bit more storage. We have a 5-bedroom house, but I could do a little bit more storage. 3-car garage, but there's no space to walk. Because we live in a society where somehow it is easy to acquire a lot of stuff. Now we have the technology where I can take food and I can store it for years. Whereas in those days, you literally had to cook your meal as you need them. You didn't have a place to keep them stored for days and end. Some of us grew up like that, where your mother don't have a fridge. She cooked 3 meals a day. There's no way to store food. So we have this society now where this is. The second thing about it is that we live in a society where, for some strange reason, we are slowly being socialized to think that stuff is more important than people. And that's where the danger is. That we value stuff more than people. We'll push the guy out of the Walmart line to get to the stuff. And don't think twice. We had a famous case in Miami where two sons, a very famous lawyer, I think the Menendez brothers or something, they couldn't wait for their mom and dad to die fast enough to inherit the stuff. So they said, we will help them. And they murdered them so that they could fast forward the process of getting the stuff from their parents, which didn't belong to them in the first place. This insatiable desire to acquire stuff that we put down, we don't value human beings anymore. This stuff is more important than humanity. People sell their baby for some drugs. The stuff is so invasive and emotionally collected that it is only, I think, in this country you see an extraordinary thing. A new iPhone will come out and people will line up for 3 days in front of the store to get this new iPhone, knowing fully well in about 3 weeks it will be available for everyone. But this desire to have it now, to have it here, and this attachment to stuff is so extraordinary. Take away an iPhone from a kid and you will see a literal breakdown, a nervous breakdown in front of your eyes. The degree of attachment to this stuff is so severe that you may have to take them to the hospital. And so we, from this background of understanding that stuff is only useful if it's helping me to do these 4 things, to be better, believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I, as the Muslim, have to be very careful about this acquisition of stuff. And it happens to the best of us. Even with one who get very pious and become very religious, you go to their homes, you will see they have like 15 hat, 20 bottle of it, 15 gongs, 40 Quran, you know. We started acquiring religious stuff. And so, unless the believer does a conscious clearing of your stuff once a month, really go through your stuff and do a cleansing. Because you have clothes, I guarantee you right now, you will never wear for the rest of your life. But you will not throw it out. You're going to leave the people who after you pass away, they got to now find places to send these things. When you grab any item of your clothes, trust me, and that's what Marie Kondo's method is. She said, grab a piece of your clothes. And as soon as you touch it, you will know if you're going to wear this ever again or not. Looking at it, you're not sure. But the moment you hold it and you look at it, I will never wear this again. I did that with every single piece of clothing that I own. And after that exercise, I give away 1/3 of my clothing. I know in my heart, I will never wear these again. They were just taking up space that I needed to put other stuff. So be very careful. We live in a materialistic world. And so first thing, believers, don't allow that. You have 5-6 cars. Why? Unless you're in the car business of buying and selling cars, why do you need so much? You know, so may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that. The second thing is relationships. We live in a world now in which a human being is considered as an object and not as a creation of Allah to be honored. Let's say, honor the son of Adam. Karamna bani Adam. We honored the humanity. We treat them as objects. And that's why it's okay. Humanity seems okay to have racist beliefs and understandings and treating each other with discrimination and bullying. It seems okay to traffic in slaves. Literally go in a country in Libya, walk into the people's country and grab all their people and start to enslave them. Because we don't see each other as Allah's beautiful creation anymore. We see them as objects to be manipulated for our own greed and purpose. And so it's okay to murder. It's okay to sell kids to get organ transplant. It's okay to, I mean, come on. You know, we begin to see one human as better than the other. This one, you know, it's okay to kill them, to maim them, to marginalize them. You know, we're not allowed to do that. And so when in this world that we're navigating, the Muslims, you and I, need to bring back that ethic of how you treat people. The Prophet ﷺ said, "Ad-deen un-nasiha." The deen is about relating nicely to people. And the third is the earth. The biggest scream we have right now is climate change, is the planet, is how we have treated the earth. The earth is dying, and slowly we are seeing amazing changes because of the greed and the excess that we want from it. We overfish the oceans. So now we don't have any food in the oceans. We cut down all the forests because we need paper for the offices. And we don't replenish fast enough to give the earth a chance to recover. And so what is happening is all that we see happening now. The earth is changing to survive. And the earth will adapt and do whatever it's necessary to survive. Even if it means wiping all of us out as part of that process. There were over 1,000 cities, I think they said, within the next few years will no longer exist because of the rising oceans. I look at my own country and I see that wall. We have a wall called the sea wall that used to protect the ocean from our country because we live below the sea level. And I would look at YouTube videos and see that huge waves coming over that wall. That wall is no longer adequate to protect us from floods and all kinds of stuff. And so as a believer, we not only have to navigate these three things, stuff, people, and how we deal with the earth. We have got to be the champions of these things. We have got to become the ones who will teach people. You know, there's these movements now, tiny homes and minimalist movements that have started to like try to rake back and says, hey, you don't need big homes. You don't need all of this. But we strike a balance. Get what you need that's comfortable. But don't have your homes consume And the way it happens is very easy. You need some paint. I only need a 1/2 gallon paint, but they only sell it in a 1 gallon tin. I can't buy the 1/2 gallon. So now I end up buying the 1 gallon. I use half, what can do the other half? It sits there. Sometimes you need a tin of something, but it's on sale and you get 2 tins. What do you do with the other tin? You know, slowly these things creep up on us. And perhaps the greatest manifestation of that is coming this week in Thanksgiving. Something called Black Friday. For us, all the Fridays are beautiful, by the way. We don't have this Black Friday and Green Friday and Red Friday. But you will see the behavior of human beings coming this week. Amazing. As they try to grab deals and they try to get things. They will push you out of the way. So be very careful and be safe. Because you're dealing with a horde of people whose stuff is very important. And if you get injured in the way, they don't really care. So try to be safe as you do your shopping and your deals. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us to live our lives in such a way that we just take from the dunya enough what you need to be comfortable and no more. And that you navigate your relationship with people, that when you meet someone and you leave them, they leave with the feeling that I have met someone so special and I would love to meet them again. In other words, that the interaction you had with them was so beautiful and so surprising to them that they would love to meet you again. And not the other way around. They can't wait to get you out of their sight of how we treat them. Whether it's your customers, whether it's your peers, your family, your wife, you want to treat people and deal with them in a way that they leave feeling, oh man, I met a special person today that really treated me well and made me feel validated as a human being. And may Allah help all our young people to champion the cause of climate change and to get involved in whatever movement and clubs that you need to, as an expression of our desire, our love for this beautiful planet that Allah has blessed us with. And we are here for a very short time. And may Allah help us to make good use of it. الحمد لله رب العالمين حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه ونشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده ونشهد ان محمدا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وبعد we have care here today that have very important announcement for the community to know. Just spend 5 minutes extra after the salah so that you could benefit from this. Care doesn't show up unless there's some very important thing that they have to tell us, and so you want to benefit from that. And so don't just rush off. Try to be here, unless you have to really get back to your work. But by and large, we're trying to give them just a couple of minutes so they can let us know some of these things that are coming, inshallah. ربنا اتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار ربنا إننا سمعنا والذي يجب علينا الإيمان الآن ذو ربكم فأمنا نستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم نتوب إليك إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله يذكركم وأقيموا الصلاة